Hello, everyone, and welcome to today's learning series, Avoid the Avalanche, three simulations exploring crowd management in the post-COVID-19 new world. My name is Kevin Bryce, and I'll be your moderator through today's learning opportunity. I represent Solutions Architecture for Accesso's ski and snow clients, as well as new snow product initiatives. Partnering with me today is Ben DeVille from Integrated Insight. Ben has a wealth of knowledge and experience evaluating processes for industry giants and a proven track record identifying hidden improvement opportunities. Ben has been a huge help as we have evaluated crowding and base area congestion in a simulated ski resort setting, and we are very excited to share with you the persuasive findings. Overall, we at Accesso recognize that this is a challenging time for our industry. We want to make sure that we are supporting our clients as best as we can, and we hope this information that we're sharing today can help you strengthen your business and serve your guests when the time comes to welcome them back to your resort. We know that you want to be a forward-thinking industry leader, and in order to do that, you need technology solutions to grow your business and create connected guest experiences. Venues around the world struggle to keep up with the evolving technology and growing guest expectations, often lacking the functionality, resources, and data they need to succeed. At Accesso, we get it, and we provide solutions that empower our clients to create connected guest experiences that drive their businesses forward. From distribution to ticketing, point of sale solutions, virtual queuing, and finally tying everything together, our guest experience engine. Our suite of solutions is ready to supplement your ski operations. With the help from Integrated Insight, we have evaluated three different combinations of workflow management techniques and simulated how the guest interaction and overall guest experience would result when implemented. The three mechanisms that we're going to cover are group-based capacity limits, timed arrival reservations, and virtual queuing. Now, virtual queuing being the most unfamiliar and likely new technique, we want to take a moment to expand and ensure everyone attending has an equal base understanding before we get into the simulations. A virtual queue, when considering a lift and gondola use case, would be defined by the theoretical uphill capacity. The virtual queue replaces the physical wait and functions much like a conventional queue, being a first in, first out process. After the virtual wait, where guests could be in the base area in an eatery or fulfilling their rental needs, guests receive a notification that it is time and the guests will approach the activity. Once arrived, guests join the buffer queue or short controlled physical wait. The queuing software maintains this buffer line at a constant pace and a constant length to not overflow into the surrounding areas. Once advanced through, the guest boards or starts their activity and is ready to book their next virtual queue entitlement. Now, just one more note before we dive into the simulations. This is a very new world, and we encourage you to be thinking about how technology as well as operational changes can supplement the way that we think outside the box. One example that you'll hear us mention a couple of times is that virtual queuing before COVID-19 was typically thought of just for access-based lifts and gondolas, and in a theme park setting, perhaps train rides or roller coaster rides. But now we're expanding and thinking of how virtual queuing could fit for crowded areas like rental shops and food and beverage as well. Now, Ben will give an overview of the process and mechanisms Integrated Insight uses to help us unfold this study. Ben?
Thanks, Kevin. As Kevin mentioned, my name is Ben DeVille, and I'm Vice President of Industrial Engineering at Integrated Insight. At Integrated Insight, we aim to help clients outbehave the competition with insights and analytics. Through our key areas of focus, new business strategy, business optimization, and research, we've developed holistic strategies and solved complex problems that have earned our clients over $2 billion over the past 10 years. As I said, here at Integrated Insight, we have three main focuses to help our clients. First is new business strategy. We aim to get it right the first time. This means helping you understand who your audience is, what they want, how much they'll pay for it, and how your operation should run. The next is business optimization. This is for pre-existing operations that want to use analytics to leverage untapped opportunities. Using advanced modeling methodologies, we help clients optimize their profit or operation while always focusing on the guest perspective. And finally, research, where we offer analysis of either online sample or provide live collection to help understand what the guests want and include that in our analysis. This slide shows a few of our clients. And while much of our experience is in the service industry and entertainment industries, we also serve clients in retail and education. The case we'll be exploring today is a sample ski resort to show how operation performs under different scenarios. Using agent-based simulation, we can calculate the effects of different operational scenarios on the safety and satisfaction of guests. Agent-based simulation uses artificially intelligent agents to navigate a 3D space to help understand their behavioral or navigational flow. Guests will navigate a 3D environment, staying in groups, and each group's actions are based on assumptions that we'll show you later in the presentation. The setup of flow for the sample ski resort utilizes a single gondola with a reduced capacity of one group, providing additional lifts uphill for guests to enjoy, has three food and beverage locations, two larger food and beverage location 1 and 3, and one smaller food and beverage location 2, a rental location that is staffed appropriately to make sure a line doesn't build. Guests are actually allowed to enter the village an hour early at 8 a.m. to queue up or get their rental equipment. Gondola begins operation at 9 a.m. and the day will close up operation at 4 p.m., allowing any guests in queue to finish their experience. When creating a simulation, we usually mock up competing scenarios to understand the impact of different operational methods on system performance. The charts on the slide show the three scenarios we investigate. The first is free-for-all, or the baseline model, that shows how guests would have arrived prior to COVID and shows what would happen if no adjustments are made to the arrival experience. You'll notice in the chart that most of the guests show up between 8:15 and 9:15, and then the demand trickles off to a consistent flow. However, we do randomize those arrivals to make sure that congestion can build and guests are behaving like they would in the real world. The next scenario is time ticketing, and that shows the result if guests are assigned arrival times and cannot access the gondola until that time. You'll notice this changes the behavior pretty dramatically, where only the first time bucket will show up prior to open, and the remainder of the guests will show up around their assigned bucket. We do have situations in the model to simulate the guests showing up early or late for their times, and that helps understand what that compounding variability will do. The final scenario shows time ticketing with a virtual queue that only allows guests to enter the virtual queue once their assigned time is reached. In this case, the guests show up later as there is no incentive to access the queue early. When building a simulation, we always collect variables that allow for experimentation. We detail those variables on this slide, starting in the upper left-hand corner with the guest initial destination. This allowed us to model where the guests go upon entering the resort. You'll notice that many of them in the free-for-all and time ticketing go straight to the gondolas, as in the free-for-all, they're allowed to go whenever they want. And in time ticketing, some of them, their time has been reached, but some proceed to rentals, and even fewer go to food and beverage. As you get to a time ticket in a virtual queue environment, you need to spread out some of the demand, as guests will have arrived early for their bucket and either go to food and beverage or a wait area outside to wait for their time to be reached. Looking at the lower left-hand corner, the guest experience level and their associated behavior is defined to help us understand how guests will experience the slopes. We define this with a skier type, novice, intermediate, or advanced, equally distributed, and then define the number of rides they'll take on the lift and the length of those runs that they make. The most important piece here is actually guests leaving the resort due to wait up in the upper right. This is based on studies we've done that shows that guests have a lower appetite for standby wait than a virtual wait. You'll notice that anything less than 40 minutes, guests tend to behave the same. But after that wait gets above 40 minutes and over an hour, guests tend to not want to wait in a standby queue, whereas they'll be okay if the wait is virtual. And finally, we need to decide the group sizes. We've equally distributed between 2, 3, and 4 guests per group to show what it looks like as far as meals served and the overall utilization of the resource. The key metrics we use to evaluate the performance are really what make the difference in the analysis we do. The queue experience measures the performance from a guest point of view and includes the number of groups in queue that leads directly to the length of the physical queue. And this is one of the more important metrics here, because you can now understand in miles how long this physical queue could build to at the worst case scenario. The next is posted wait time, which is the wait time a guest will be shown when they get into queue. And then the average wait time, which is the actual wait time a guest waited averaged over all of the groups. The next bucket is food and beverage, and this measures the number of groups served. And this differs because of where the guests are spending their queuing time. In a virtual queue, they can go in and buy a coffee or a hot dog while they're waiting for the gondola. And finally, Resort Performance monitors a number of groups skiing, leaving because the wait is too long, and the overall number of groups in the resort. When performing the analysis, we like to look at milestones to understand how the scenarios compare at similar times throughout the day. The milestones we used in this analysis were when the gondola opened, to understand all of those guests who are arriving early and what their experience looks like, when the queue fills, at what time, and what the wait time looks like, at peak operation, which is when the most guests are in the resort, and finally, when the congestion clears, allowing us to understand how long that peak operation was happening and what impacts that had to the guest experience. Digging into the analysis, the free-for-all scenario shows that the queue fills fastest and therefore has a longer wait time when the gondola opens. You'll notice in picture one that the queue is over half full when the gondola opens at 9 a.m. Picture two shows the queue filling at 9:45 a.m. with a posted wait time already over 100 minutes, leading to a poor guest experience. Moving to picture three, this is showing the peak of the operation, and you can see that the queue is spilled over outside of the socially distanced area. And from our experience, this is where the queue gets very dangerous and guests can't socially distance themselves, especially when they're in groups. And finally, this shows the congestion clearing in picture four at 1:20 p.m., but you'll notice the posted wait time is still 106 minutes. And on average, guests that have gotten on the gondola have waited about 122 minutes. Now we'll actually dig into a movie and watch guests flow in the resort at the absolute peak of the operation. You'll notice that some groups have entered food and beverage as it's right around noon and they're getting hungry, but the majority of guests are still in queue to board the gondola and go up to the top of the hill. Now, as we zoomed in, you'll see the congestion outside the socially distanced queue. You'll notice guests behaving themselves in the queue, but once those socially distanced markers end, the guests really don't know where to stand, and we've seen this live in theme parks and stadiums across the country. You'll notice that metric I mentioned earlier, length of queue needed. We're showing here that you would need over a half mile of queue to host the 281 groups that want to wait in line. Now, obviously, you could let fewer guests in, but the positive here is as we move through the scenarios, we'll show you ways to have guests in your resort and still provide them a better experience than standing up in a 120-minute line. Moving on to that next scenario, these are the milestones in the time ticketing scenario and shows that the congestion clears slowly once peak operation is hit. Upon gondola opening, the queue is actually now only about a quarter full, providing a better guest experience at the beginning of the day. The queue fills about an hour and a half later, as guests are only allowed in the gondola line when their time's been reached. But you'll notice the posted wait time still 106 minutes because you have those 215 guests in queue. The peak operation still hits at noon because that's when all of the guests have arrived for the day. The posted wait time is still about 140 minutes, and the average wait time over the entire morning is about 41 minutes, including those guests that had very little wait to start the day. The congestion clears here a little bit later than the free-for-all, and that's because fewer guests have left because they were unhappy with the wait. Because you're letting guests in later in the day, that wait builds slower and fewer guests are dissatisfied. So now as we move to the time ticketed scenario movie, you'll notice there's fewer guests in queue, but that's only the case for a short amount of time. The posted wait time is still about 120 minutes. As I've said, the average wait time is lower because fewer guests in the morning were allowed in queue. And one major difference is more groups have been served in food and beverage because one of their destinations to start with is a food and beverage if they've arrived earlier than their time. And finally, we'll go through the milestones with time ticketing and virtual queue, which is a better experience for guests and much faster. You notice that gondola open, there's not very many people in the buffer queue. This is because people know they can get into the virtual queue. They don't have to get there early to stand. And many are in food and beverage or waiting in an outside wait area. Moving down to picture two, this shows the longest buffer queue at around 9:40. You don't have a time when that buffer queue is filled because the virtual queuing system limits the number of guests that are called and therefore have to stand on their feet. But you'll notice at peak operation, you still have a very long posted wait time of 130 minutes, but that's a virtual wait. So again, fewer people are leaving because they have a higher appetite for a virtual wait. All of your food and beverage locations are actually at capacity. So we'd have to work with operations to understand what kind of kiosks or picnic tables or other entertainment areas we could build for the guests to make their wait time shorter. And that's shown in the food and beverage group served as 182 guests had been served compared to 161 in the time ticket and much, much fewer in the free-for-all. Now, looking at the virtual queue scenario, it looks a lot better, but there's still work to be done. This is the case in a project where we would work with operations to understand what these guests are doing, how many of them are waiting, and how we can mitigate their time that they're spending waiting outside. You notice the buffer queue is moving quickly. Guests spend very little time, no more than 10 minutes in that queue. And guests are able to socially distance themselves outside of the queue or wait in the food and beverage locations that are currently at capacity, providing the ability to sell more if kiosks were set up. The final step in the process is to analyze the metrics that we've collected. The chart here shows the comparison of free-for-all, time ticketing, and virtual queue. And some highlights are the average wait is controlled early in the day due to time ticketing limiting the wait for those arriving. You'll notice the free-for-all peak is 51, time ticketing and virtual queue dropping to 20 and 30 respectively. The posted wait time, however, at peak is much, much higher as you're letting the same number of groups in, but again, that virtual queue experience is that much better. And that's actually shown by the number of total groups leaving due to wait, where you see that over 100 more guests leave in the free-for-all scenario as they're dissatisfied compared to the virtual queue, where they have a higher appetite to hang out at the bottom of the mountain. This sample model represents a rather simple ski resort, but this technology can be used to replicate any ski resort operation and see the impacts of various operational changes would have on your guests. If you'd like more information, please email me.
Thank you so much, Ben. Really appreciate the hard work from you and your team as we unfolded what we think might be an upcoming situation for various ski resorts this season. It should be noted that this isn't the worst of situations to look at. This is considering a ski resort with a gondola, an 8, 10, or 12 person lift mechanism bringing guests from the village up to the snow. Other resorts with aerial trams that might be moving hundreds of people at a time have a very different situation, and we'd be more than interested to help understand and predict where there might be pinches in the operational flows and suggest technology, methods, and tools that can help garner a more successful, better experience, not only for your operators and staff, but for your guests as well. If anything that was presented in this presentation is of interest, has created new questions or new curiosities, we'd be really excited for you to reach out to us here at Accesso. We think virtual queuing fits really well in the ski atmosphere, both for lifts, gondolas, and aerial trams moving people up the hill to their activities. But in addition to that, at eateries, rentals, guest services, and other facilities that you might need to control queuing for and guest total capacity. If anything sounds interesting or you have more questions, please do reach out. We'd be really excited to unfold opportunities and solutions for your ski resort.